But silicon carbide, one of the very good properties, especially for industry, you can switch it much faster, higher frequencies. And this is done also in the applications, but that also means that the silicon carbide device itself sees much more switching cycles. We try to go to the limit or a little bit above and then see in testing what happens. Do we see anything that can also happen in the application?
This is the podcast for engineers. The podcast you just have to listen to if you're interested in what's going on in the semiconductor market. My name is Kelsey Markle, and today we're talking about silicon carbide reliability. I'm joined by my colleague, Paul Salmen, who is here from Warstein. He's responsible for quality and reliability in silicon carbide power modules for industrial applications. Paul,
hi.
So happy to have you here today.
Yeah, thanks for the invitation.
So, Paul, I gave you a bit of an introduction, but maybe you tell me a little bit more and our audience a little bit more about what you do. What does it mean, reliability in silicon carbide, for you?
Yeah, so I'm working as a quality engineer. So I studied physics and then started at Infineon 7 years ago and more or less directly went into silicon carbide reliability. And reliability in the semiconductor context means that we don't only want to produce devices that work in the lab, so you buy them and they are great, but they age very quickly, but we want to be sure that the devices we sell really work for the 10, 20, or even 30 years that that the customer wants to use them.
Okay, so how do we ensure that our products or that semiconductors in general last a long time?
Yeah, so simplest way would be you put the device into the application. So we built our own inverter, put it in the application and let it run for 20 years. And then we are sure that it works, we can start selling it. Problem is our device development then also needs 20 years and that is much too long. So to do some or to ensure that the device works reliable, we have to accelerate the testing. We have to get it much faster and see much faster how does it age, would it survive in the application or not. And therefore, in reliability testing, we try to accelerate whatever is possible, for example, using much higher temperatures. Normally, the device is not operated at maximum temperature, but if you want to see how are ions in the or around the semiconductor moving, best way is use very high temperatures. Maybe combine it with maximum blocking voltage, and then you really attract everything that is there and can see aging much faster than in the normal application. And by this, and of course, you have to understand then how this relates to conditions in the application. But if you do it like this, you can really within 1,000 hours or less or more, depends, but these are roughly 2 months, you can then see how the device will behave in the application.
Okay, Paul, so we've talked a lot about power semiconductors, silicon, GaN, silicon carbide. Now, we have decades of experience with silicon. It's been on the market for decades now. What have we learned from these years and years of experience testing with silicon, and how are we applying that to silicon carbide testing?
So we use all what we learned from silicon. As I said before, we have, for example, high temperatures and we stress at high temperatures and high blocking voltages. And for the beginning, just apply the tests we know from silicon also to silicon carbide to see what happens. Mm-hmm. But there are also things that change directly. For silicon, we needed time, or at the beginning, everybody used humidity testing just at 80 volts. So humidity testing means in the application, the device also gets humid air around it, and it will lead to corrosion of metals, for example. Mm-hmm. So you have to be sure that your semiconductor can withstand this corrosion process and it does not harm your device, so that mainly the metals do not corrode. And for silicon, we started with 80 volts. And then later went to higher voltages, but always the devices used were always 1200 volt devices. And for silicon carbide, we more or less skipped this 80 volts test and the higher blocking higher voltages in tests. So normally humidity test is done at 80% of rated device voltage. So 960 volt typically, we directly went to this step, and this is directly industry standard to mm-hmm. use this much higher voltages than compared to silicon.
And this is because of the material, the differences in the materials of silicon to silicon carbide.
Yes, it's so partially leakage current plays a role. With early silicon devices, you could not do the high voltage. You would have had too much leakage current and the device would have directly dried. But it's also that silicon carbide can have higher field. It can withstand higher fields, and you have then higher fields in edge termination and so on. And so you're much more sensitive also if you do a mistake in device design that you can see an earlier aging. So also therefore, it is important to use the higher voltages.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned humidity. Is there anything else?
Yes, we also learned that if you come from silicon, we did a lot of static testing, so we did not use much switching. But silicon carbide, one of the very good properties, especially for industry, you can switch it much faster, higher frequencies. And this is done also in the applications, but that also means that the silicon carbide device itself sees much more switching cycles. And in the reliability testing for silicon carbide, we also looked on this during the development and found that if you switch the device, you get additional AJ mechanisms that are not there for silicon. So silicon carbide MOSFETs, we developed a test that includes gate stress switched, like in the application, and not only static as it was for silicon.
Okay. So a lot of new aspects that we need to think about. How did we discover all of these new?
Yeah, so when starting a device development, we of course think about material properties. What does silicon carbide make difference? It's different mechanically, it's different electrically. So a lot of different properties. And how can this affect the device aging and what can happen to the device in the application. But we also additionally do application year testing. So we build test benches that are like an inverter running in the field, just also with accelerated conditions, higher frequencies, higher temperatures, trying to put everything to the limit to see if the device changes in a way.
You said application near, so trying to replicate as closely as possible a real world scenario, right?
Yes, but with the one difference, as I said at the beginning, we could just go into the application and say, hey, we test for 20 years. If we do that, it needs too long. So you really have to try to accelerate in every mean. Mm-hmm. Customers don't use so high gate voltages. What is the limit in the data sheet? We try to go to the limit or a little bit above and then see in testing what happens. Do we see anything that can also happen in the application?
Okay, yeah, wouldn't be a very good business model to say you can get a new product in 20 years.
Yes, and 20 years later, you get the next one.
That okay.
It's a lot of time.
How can customers learn about the reliability tests? Do we produce any publications? Where you mentioned data sheets.
So about this gate switching instability, the failure mechanism I mentioned before. For example, we have an application note that is linked in the data sheets where it's relevant. Mm-hmm. But we also try to bring it into standardization. So we write also papers, scientific papers, publications, and we also then go into the standardization committees like JEDEC and start writing or supporting there to write guidelines. And for example, this gate switching instability, there is now a JEDEC document, an official industry guideline, how to test for that, what is a failure mechanism about, so that not only we have a reliable design, but everybody is able to develop reliable SiC inverters.
Okay, so the standard came from some of the testing we were doing within.
Yeah, we were the first ones publishing about this, of course, and also others, universities and so on, took on. But yes, so we were the ones finding this mechanism.
Okay, let's go back to applications for a minute. Do the different applications for SiC play a big role in the way that we test?
Yes. And it depends strongly which application you have. You have different conditions. Some things like a drive motor is mainly used in-house or sealed. But you have other ones like, for example, solar, where silicon carbide is used a lot, where you are out in the field. So really that your solar panels are somewhere on the outside and you have a lot of humidity that can play a role there. Or EV charging, if you think about the big EV chargers on the motorways and so on, that can do hundreds of kilowatt. There also, you're somewhere outside and you will have humidity there. And it even might be that everything is cold at night. You might have something like condensation and then someone comes and starts charging your car or his car. And this then can lead to a lot of stress to the semiconductor. And that's why for these kind of applications, we also have invented tests where we try to mimic this using a very humid environment. So trying to mimic this very harsh conditions that can from time to time happen in the application, just much more condensed and accelerated in a reliability test.
Okay, EV charging. You mentioned a lot of different things, humidity, temperatures, condensation, but we have silicon carbide for a variety of applications. Can you mention any other applications that might be different?
Yes,
a
very good example is traction. So for us, you could say trains driving around and the motor of a train. And for this, if you think about it, first one thing for this application, it has very long runtimes. A train should run for 30 years or more, so the devices in the train should work that long. On the other side, the train many times starts driving, stops driving. You have a lot of thermal cycles, so a lot of thermal stress. For modules, this is a test we do then power cycling, where silicon carbide, due to its material properties, it's just very hard and does a lot of stress to the interconnection technologies, leads to an earlier end of life. So silicon carbide does not survive that long as silicon at the moment with normal interconnection technologies. It's not a problem in most applications, and you can adopt and you can get specifications from Infineon, but for traction, this would not work. Then the train, you cannot design with this a train running for 30 years. And there we directly looked at this into device, or took this in the device development and implemented our .XT technology with silicon carbide, enabling that the train can really run for 30 years and that you will not see much aging of the interconnection technologies. So it's really, that was one of the key points of the device design, that you go into this reliability aspect and solve the problem that customers have to limit how they use the device. And that, of course, can also be used then later for other applications.
Yeah, we had an episode recently with Conrad and Kasper where we talked about .XT interconnection technology for the XHP2, and it was interesting to see how they troubleshooted the different aspects of silicon carbide from a material standpoint to compensate for some of the limitations of the material. But it sounds like you are passionate about reliability. Infineon is passionate about reliability. Can you tell me a little bit about how we take that passion into our product development?
Yes. So it's right. We are very passionate about it. And you can directly see it at the beginning of our process. So we have a trench MOSFET. Most competitors have the D-MOSFETs, planar MOSFETs, yes. And we've chosen the trench MOSFET before because it's better performance. But especially you can use a thicker gate oxide, which enables us already in the production to have a better screening. And with this, we can delete all field relevant gate oxide defects, which is or was a big topic for silicon carbide. And so just by choosing this design, we already ensured that we only sell devices that work in the application and where you don't where you are not limited by the gate oxide defects. There is, by the way, also a training at the moment on the webpage, on the product pages, where we explain how we do that and how that works.
Okay, the training video sounds really interesting. I'll try to link it in the episode description if anyone listening is interested in learning more. To wrap things up, we've talked about silicon carbide evolving into now wide band gap technologies like silicon carbide. We talked about our decades of experience watching this development and pushing the boundaries of reliability in silicon carbide. How do we expect things to continue to evolve over the next years or decades?
Yeah. So the big trend at the moment affecting also reliability is that, of course, now many people have SiC MOSFETs. And of course, now they start shrinking, doing second generations, third generations. And this also means you get much higher current densities in the material, which of course also affects reliability, interconnection technologies, your bond wires, which connect the chip, get much higher current densities. And all of this, you also have to reflect in device development and ensure that it still works in a reliable way. And this is will be the big topic for reliability in the future.
So it sounds like we're going to have a lot to look forward to when it comes to the development of reliability in silicon carbide in the future. So thank you, Paul, so much for being here. Before we say goodbye, you mentioned that our listeners can find more information about SiC reliability in app notes. Are there any other resources besides the training videos, the app notes that they can reference?
Yeah, one big thing, we have a white paper on silicon carbide reliability, really big document showing how we do gate oxide testing and how our devices age, what happens with the devices, and trying to explain this to the customer. And we're at the moment working on an update of this. Mm-hmm. So you can look on the Infineon webpage and hopefully soon find the updated white paper, where you then also find what we did in the last years and what we think is important about silicon carbide reliability.
Okay, fantastic, Paul. We'll link that in the show notes. So infineon.com/SIC is a good go-to resource for all things silicon carbide. Thank you, Paul, again. And to our listeners, stay tuned for more on wide band gap, silicon carbide, and power semiconductors.